live streaming training, and I want to test the technology. And the next step is going to be some live classroom type training online. So if you're interested in participating in that, I'd be just shoot me an email and I'd be very happy to entertain that and connect with you, especially if you're techie and you really don't have anything better to do than hang out with me and test technology. All right. So we are going to talk about the TXV. We're just going to, the last live training we did, we discussed the fixed orifice and the piston and the refrigeration cycle there. But we're going to take a look at now at the TXV valve construction, how it operates, how to place the sensing bulb, and then we'll go through the refrigeration cycle with the TXV in the system, just the basic refrigeration cycle with the TXV. Okay, so the last training that we had, we talked about the piston, and it's a pretty bulletproof, trouble-free metering device. And that's a picture of it right there. And if you look at it on the end, there is, it's just a basically a calibrated bore right here. Let me make this, let's make this little, this line a little thicker. How's that? It's that bore is calibrated to match the system. And all that does is reduce the pressure of the refrigerant. The only, it's big enough that most, if there's any debris in there, it's going to pass through. Normally, it's going to have to be a pretty big size chunk of stuff to get through there. So, but it doesn't give us very good control over different load changes like a TXV does. So as we get into the higher and higher efficiency equipment, TXVs are going to become more popular. Oh, and the other thing, if you look on your screen on the right there, there's a question box if you have some questions. I can't see that while I'm doing the screen share, but I'll pop back and check for questions at the end of the presentation here. All right, here's a picture of a Sporlin TXV. We'll take a look at some of the basic components that are common to every TXV. So you can't see the sensing bulb. That's out here. We'll take a look at that a little bit later, but the sensing bulb is out there. This is the diaphragm. So when the sensing bulb is connected to the top of the diaphragm, valve body, the needle orifice is right here. This is what meters the refrigerant. Inlet screen, we'll take a little bit more look at that in more detail. And then the spring adjuster and packing gland. Now, not all TXVs and residential systems have a spring adjuster. They're fixed, so you cannot adjust the superheat. In the commercial systems and refrigeration systems, they are. But we're going to take a look at a commercial one, a residential one right now. Okay, so here's an exploded view of what we just looked at. So let's break it down. All right, this is commonly called the power head or the thermostatic element, and it is connected to the sensing bulb with a small capillary tube. In the sensing bulb is refrigerant, usually the same refrigerant that's in the system. So when we're talking about refrigerant, when the temperature of the refrigerant increases, so does the pressure. So when we have a temperature increase on this bulb, that pressure increase is transmitted through to the top of the power head, and it pushes down on this diaphragm right here. So that pressure comes through that tube, and it pushes down on the diaphragm, which pushes down on these seats. Let's take a look at that. All right. So the pressure increase in the sensing bulb pushes down on the diaphragm, and these seats right here rest right up against the diaphragm. And then they travel through the entire valve body when it's all put together. And they come down here and they also hit this pin carrier. So it's a direct connection between that diaphragm up here and the pin carrier below. So we have the sensing bulb pressure pushing down, which pushes down on the seats via the push rods. And we'll go over this a little bit more as well. So that is the opening pressure of the TXV, because what it does is it pushes down on that pin carrier, and then it pushes, allows the seat to open up a little bit and allows refrigerant to flow through. Now on the other side of the pin carrier, there's the superheat spring. So that pushes upwards on the pin carrier, and the seat is what meters the refrigerant through the valve. So we have the sensing bulb pushing down on the seat, opening the TXV. We have the superheat spring pushing up on the TXV, trying to force it closed. And there's also another force that it is involved in the TXV. Back up there. So those are your main components. Now we have the, in this picture, this is the inlet. We have high pressure, high temperature liquid entering the TXV. And then coming out of that TXV, we have saturated vapor that's low pressure, low temperature. And then this is the equalizer connection. And I'll explain that here in just a little bit. One thing that you need to be aware of is the inlet of this TXV, where the high pressure, high temperature liquid enters the TXV, there is a screen here, and that keeps debris from getting inside the TXV. Unlike the piston, where you can have some rather large pieces of crap going through there, TXV doesn't serve a TXV very well, because it's got a tiny orifice that opens and closes, and it tends to get plugged up. So this screen is there to filter that out. Many times, if you think you have a bad TXV, you need to check that screen before you replace the TXV, because if it's filled with debris because of poor installation techniques and practices, it's going to look like a bad TXV. Okay, so the TXV, it has one opening pressure and two closing pressures to maintain constant superheat. So let's look at that. Those are not pressures, but forces. So we'll go over this again. Sensing bulb is the opening force. As the pressure increases, at the temperature increases, the pressure increases, it pushes down on the diaphragm, pushes down on the push rods. That pushes down against the superheat spring and opens up the TXV valve to let more refrigerant flow through. And all the time, at the same time, that superheat spring is trying to maintain that superheat and keep it closed. Now we have the equalizer connection, and that is what that does is it is connected to the outlet of the evaporator, because there are some pressure differences between the inlet, which is right here, and the outlet. So what it does is it allows this TXV to think that it is sensing that, well, it does, it senses the outlet pressure, even though it is right there on the inlet of the evaporator. And this is the other opening force, I'm sorry, the other closing force on the TXV. So the closing forces are the superheat spring, the equalizer pressure, which is your suction pressure at the outlet of the evaporator, and the sensing bulb is your opening force. All right, so let's take a look first before we get into how the TXV operates in a system at the pressure temperature chart. Now this comes out of our textbook, and in this example, we're going to be using R22, which is the green column. We can ignore any of these other columns here. The green column is our pressure column. And then over here is our temperature column right here. All right, so when you're familiar with that, because we're going to be bouncing back and forth between the two. And also, This is a pressure temperature chart. You probably have a card if you're a technician. If you're not one of my students, you can get these pressure temperature cards from the supply house. This is also what your gauges read. So when your gauges are looking at, and you're looking at your gauges and it's reading 62, 63 PSI on your gauges, you know that the pressure temperature relationship between the on R22 is 62 PSI is equal to 36 degrees Fahrenheit. And that just corresponds to your gauges as well. Okay, so let's break this diagram down just a little bit. So here is our TXV in the system here. And then we're looking at it through the magnifying glass. Here's the magnifying glass view. Our sensing bulb is attached to the outlet of the evaporator. Now, this isn't the outlet of the evaporator down here. This is a text box that you will fill in a little bit later. But this bulb right here is mounted on the outlet of the evaporator. Here is the sensing bulb is filled with refrigerant. The pressure is transferred up here to the top of the diaphragm. Here's our push rods. Here's the valve seat that it pushes down on. So here you can see as the pressure increases on the diaphragm because of a temperature increase at the bulb, it pushes these pins down onto the seat and it opens up the TXV. So this is our incoming line right here, high pressure, high temperature liquid from the condensing coil. And it comes down through this seat, and that seat is opened and closed by the forces of the TXV, and it drops the pressure, drops the temperature, and it allows the refrigerant to enter the evaporator coil. Now this TXV doesn't have an equalizer valve on it because it would just clutter up the diagram and confuse things just a little bit. So opening force is the sensing bulb. Closing force is the superheat spring. And you can see here that the evaporator pressure pushes up back up against the bottom of the diaphragm. Okay, so we have R22 system, and it's here, it says it's at 54 degrees Fahrenheit and 91 PSIG. So how do we get that? So, I'm sorry, let's back up. We're not gonna do that yet. We're gonna go over here first before we talk about that. Okay, we'll come back to this. Let's take a look at this side of the system first. This is our evaporator right here. This is the evaporator coil. You have your gauges on the system and it's reading 67 PSIG right here. So let's look at our pressure temperature chart. 67 PSIG with R22, remember that. 67 PSIG at R22 is right about there. There's 67.1. We read it over and it's 39 degrees. Okay, so this evaporator coil, and there you go, it says it's 40 degrees right there. So 40 degrees at the evaporator coil, that's how we get it. You could do that with your pressure temperature chart or from your gauges would tell you that it's 40 degrees, but I just wanted to show you that pressure temperature relationship that refrigerant has. Okay, so our refrigerant is changing state here in the evaporator coil, and it is at 40 degrees Fahrenheit and 67 PSIG. But as it comes down to the end of the evaporator coil, it starts to pick up our superheat. And our bulb, sensing bulb from the TXV is mounted on the outlet of the evaporator. So this bulb here is sensing 54 degree Fahrenheit temperature from the evaporator tubing. So 54 degree Fahrenheit temperature. Is equivalent to 91 PSIG of closing force on the top of the TXV diaphragm. So let's take a look at that. So we have 91 PSIG and 54 degrees Fahrenheit. Let's look at our pressure temperature chart again. So let's find 91 PSIG here. So this is our PSIG column. So that's going to be just about here. Because 92.6 is 55, 91 is right in there at about 54 degrees. Can you see that? Okay. So we have 91 PSIG of opening pressure on the top of the diaphragm. And remember, the closing forces are the spring and the suction pressure. So our 91 PSIG coming down, suction pressure is 67 PSIG. So the evaporator pressure, 67 PSIG again, right there. 40 degrees Fahrenheit, 67 PSIG is pushing back up in this direction. So we have 67 pushing up in this direction, 91 pushing down in that direction. Okay, so the spring pressure helps maintain the superheat. So what is the difference between 91 PSIG and 67 PSIG is 14 PSIG. So that spring pressure has to be 14 degrees or 14 PSIG to keep everything in equilibrium. So as the bulb temperature increases and we push down on the TXV and it opens up the seat, it allows more refrigerant to flow through, which when more refrigerant flows through the evaporator coil, it's going to lower the temperature eventually. In about 10 or 15 minutes, it's going to lower the temperature down here at the outlet of the evaporator coil, and it's going to balance out this TXV and maintain a 14 PSIG superheat on the outlet of the evaporator coil. And conversely, if the temperature drops too low, then it's going to release, this 91 PSIG is going to decrease, and it's going to allow the TXV to close up just a little bit. So this is like cruise control on your car. So when you're going up the hill, it opens up throttle, lets more gas through to maintain your speed. When you're going downhill, it closes the throttle, reduces the amount of fuel into your car, and maintains the speed whether you're going uphill or downhill. That's the same thing the TXV does when there are temperature increases or decreases. So as the temperature increases in the system, it opens up the valve and allows more refrigerant to flow through and maintain the same superheat. And conversely, when it cools down or you're going downhill, it closes off that, throttles back that refrigerant and maintains that constant superheat. All right. Okay, sensing bulb placement. So as you can see here, sensing bulb is pretty much the variable here. So if you don't have the sensing bulb placed properly, you're not gonna have proper TXV operation in the system. So let's take a look at that. So if the outside diameter of the suction line is greater than 7/8 of an inch, equal to or greater than 7/8 of an inch, you should place that bulb, manufacturers recommend, between 8 o'clock and 4 o'clock. Now, if it's smaller than 7/8, you can place it anywhere between 4 and 8 o'clock. And I'll show you why here in just a minute. But you never want to put the sensing bulb at the bottom. Keep it out of the, from 4 to 8 o'clock, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 o'clock, keep it out of that range. Here's why. So when you have this is a cross-sectional view of your piping, there's oil in this system. So if you mount the bulb down here at the bottom, it insulates the bulb from the actual pressure of the vapor. If you have a 7/8 inch or larger suction line, this is warmer vapor that migrates up here to the top. And if it's a larger suction line, there's a larger area for that warmer vapor to accumulate. So if you have that bulb mounted too far up here, you're going to, above the 4 and 8 o'clock sections, you're going to start measuring the warmer vapor on top. You don't want to do that. You want it to measure that saturated, not the saturated, but the refrigerant itself as close to the center of that pipe as you can. And just remember, the bulbs mounted on the side of pipe is a good general rule of thumb. If you keep it on the side of the pipe, not near the bottom or at the top. There's another thing you need to pay attention to when you're mounting a TXV. Remember, this is really the variable force of the TXV itself, the major variable force. It needs to be in very close contact and tight contact with the suction line. So, you know, I've seen zip ties being used. That's not a really good way to connect a bulb to the suction line. You can use the radiator clamps. Those are great and easy, or you can use the brass ones that come with the new TXVs to mount that. But you got to make sure that it is tight and it's mounted securely. And you don't want to mount it on any type of bend or any braze joint, because then you get this gap here. And if you follow behind someone who is careless in doing this, this is going to cause improper operation of the TXV and poor cooling for the customer. So those are some things to look at when you are either troubleshooting or mounting a TXV. Never on any of these joints that you see here. Always tight up against this pipe. The other thing, now this is one that you don't run into very often, but when you do, you'll be the hero. So when a TXV is on the vertical line, a vertical suction line, you always need to mount it with the tubing at the top. And don't mount it on a vertical line unless you don't have any place that you can mount it horizontally that makes any sense. But if it's mounted there, you need to have that tubing on the top, because if you mount it upside down, this bulb is filled with, it's got refrigerant in here. So this bottom part right here, that is liquid. Up here is vapor. And if you mount it upside down, that liquid migrates down into the top of the TXV, and it loses some of the refrigerant that it needs in the bulb to operate the TXV properly. So if the temperature of the suction line increases too much, and there's a lot of this refrigerant has flowed down to the head of the bulb, it's all run out of the bulb, then the bulb loses its ability to meter that refrigerant properly. And especially, this won't manifest itself unless you have a real high heat load, and this suction line is getting warm and warming up, and there's no more refrigerant in this bulb, then the TXV fails to operate. It just sits there. So what you'll need to do is, if you find this and you want to make sure the TXV bulb is working properly, you'll have to unmount it and then flip it upside down and let it hang for a while. Now you can put it in some cold water, because the refrigerant will migrate down into that bulb, and then remount the system and then run it for 15 or 20 minutes to see if it's operating. This is, you don't see it very often, but when you do, most of the time when you flip it upside down and get it running again and back into its normal position, it's going to correct the problem. It looks like we lost our diagram for the, let's see if we can find it. Hold on. We lost our diagram for the refrigeration cycle. Okay, so then obviously it's time for questions. And then we'll do this. After this presentation, I will schedule another live online training, and we'll cover the refrigeration cycle a little bit more in depth with a TXV, and we'll cover the normal refrigeration cycle, overcharge and undercharge. All right, so let me pop back here and let's see what we have for questions. Okay, so guys, you have any questions there? Anything you need to go back over? Yeah, you just type them up there. On the right-hand side of your screen, it should be a place for questions. And again, we're testing this out for okay, so I'm going to give you a few more 4 minutes to come up with questions. We can always go back and review, see if there's anything that you need. All right, gents. Well, thank you for helping me test out this new technology. We'll record this video, edit it, and put it up on the class in our classroom online for review. And then I will contact and email you when we have the follow-up to this live training. All right. Thanks very much.